السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household and all his companions, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us. My brothers and sisters in Islam, each one of us has needs, and we call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes we call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill our needs, and we feel that perhaps the response is not coming as we like it. The question is why? And I will spend the next 30 minutes, inshallah, speaking about why sometimes the prayers that we make, we feel that they are not answered. What is it that I can do to make myself a person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to as quickly as possible? Knowing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith that every single time a believer calls out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in whatever they are calling out to him about, there is no sin or there is no breaking of family ties, nothing unlawful, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the mu'min or the believer responds to him in one of three ways. Either he gives him what he wants immediately as he wants it, or he keeps for him later on something even better. And this would mean two things. One is, in the akhirah, when a person passes away, he will see great reward and he will be told that this is actually the recompense of those du'as, those supplications you made in the world, which perhaps you did not get as you wanted. We are recompensing you with something even better on this day. That's the second thing. Or the third part of the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, as a result of the dua or the supplication that was made unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some calamity that was on the path of this individual will actually be extinguished or minimized. So they will feel the blessing of it in a totally different way that Allah knows best. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum asked a beautiful question, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, so shouldn't we increase? Shouldn't we just continue making dua no matter what? And he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always above. You can increase as you want. Allah will always give you one of these three. Sometimes in this world, if the timing is not right for what you want, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps it for the correct timing. Say I'm making dua, oh Allah grant me a good job. And perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants me to get a far better job than those mediocre jobs that are coming perhaps in my path. And He keeps me going for a year, 2 years, and then I get a job of my dreams. Yet I perhaps might have been losing a little bit of hope in the interim. And for this reason, one of the reasons why we are not answered to as we would like is because we lose hope very quickly in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith says, يُسْتَجَابُ لِأَحَدِكُمْ مَا لَمْ يَسْتَعْجِلْ. Your du'as will be responded for as long as you do not make haste. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wanted to know, what is the meaning of making haste, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He says, for you to say, oh, I called out to Allah and I've been calling out to Allah, but He has not responded to me. Astaghfirullah. Allah heard you even before you uttered your dua. He already knew it from the time it was in your heart. And He knows it, and when you utter it, you are just confirming. And this is why the hadith teaches us not to scream out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua. You know, you yelling at the top of your voice and you like Allah is not hearing you. No, you call out passionately with conviction. And this is why another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, and quite clearly, he says that those whose hearts are not convinced will not be responded to by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way they've wished. So what happens sometimes is a person calls out to Allah but is not convinced that that is going to happen. You know, you're asking Allah for something big and in your heart you say, I don't think that will actually happen. Which means you are insulting Allah. There is nothing that is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you want something, you ask Allah with conviction and you keep on asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are other keys. There are other keys that we have in our bunch to open the door. What are these keys? The first thing, remember to start off by the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is a way and a means of starting your dua. You want to ask Allah, you first start off by praising Him. Declare His praise. We are saying Alhamdulillah and so many other terms. Oh Allah, You are the greatest. You are my maker. I am at Your mercy. I thank You for everything You've given me. I appreciate whatever I have. I really am so weak. You are the only one I call out to. Ya Allah, I've raised my hands to You. I am helpless. All these are a very, very good introduction to your dua. It's a key that will open the door quicker because you are expressing how helpless you are and how all-giving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Then blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is of utmost importance because he is the one who was sent to take us out of the darkness and to show us the light. It would be wrong for us to call out to Allah when the one who taught us how to call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is outside the equation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and may He make us realize the value of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Indeed, the best of creation, the most honored of all of the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also of importance, another part of the same key is for us to become on the same page with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So sometimes we just say, oh Allah, give me this. Oh Allah, give me that. But we have not yet sought forgiveness for the sins we've been committing all along. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would like us to be on the same page, which means when He tells us something, we respond. So when we ask Him something, He responds even quicker. Whoever goes close to Allah a handspan, He comes closer to Him a foot. Whoever goes closer to Allah walking, Allah comes towards Him rushing. What do we learn from that? We learn definitely from that the more we are in obedience of Allah, the more Allah will open our doors, subhanallah. إن تنصروا الله ينصركم ويثبت أقدامكم. O you who believe, if you are to fulfill the instruction of Allah, then He will come to your help. Subhanallah. If you have to fulfill, you try your best to fulfill the duties upon you to abstain from the prohibitions, that is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you. That is when He will come to your assistance. And the verse says, and He will strengthen you. يُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ He will make firm your feet on the ground. He will make sure that you are steadfast because you are trying. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to help ourselves. Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, importantly, you want Allah to respond to you? Ask yourself for a minute, how well do I respond to Allah? حَيَّ عَلَى الْفَلَاحِ Come to success. But we are moving far away from the masjid. We move far away from salah. Suddenly, oh Allah, safeguard me. There are these robbers in front of me. Ya Allah, protect me. Allah says, you know what? You don't deserve it, but I will still protect you. Amazing. Imagine. You don't deserve it, but I'll still give it to you. You know why? I made you and I love you. Allahu Akbar. Amazing. Allah gives us all, even what we do not deserve. This is why sometimes a person says, I've been making dua and Allah's been responding. But if you look at the life of that person, sometimes it's not up to scratch, so to speak. But that's the mercy of Allah. Allah is so merciful. Although we have all these beautiful teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes out of the gift of Allah, in fact, all the time, out of the gift of Allah, certain things He still blesses us with. Even though if you look at reality and how we've been leading our lives, we actually do not deserve it. We actually do not deserve it. Sometimes we are faulty with Salatul Fajr. The most important sign of the link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Salatul Fajr, your Salatul Isha, your prayer at large, your link with your maker. We are found wanting when it comes to the prayer. And still Allah says, but I will still give you, one day you will turn. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a turning point. So my brothers and sisters, here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is telling us to seek forgiveness. seek forgiveness. So when I start making my dua, I praise Allah. I express how weak I am, how dependent I am to Allah. I send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the first thing I do, I say, oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive me. I've been weak. Whatever I've done is not enough. Ya Allah, there are sins I've committed. Forgive me for them. Ya Allah, there are good deeds that I haven't fulfilled. Ya Allah, forgive me for that. I can be a better person. Oh Allah, help me to gain closeness to you. I have not yet asked what I want. I have not yet asked what I want. I'm only praising Allah and I'm seeking forgiveness so that now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me. And He sees this. But sometimes, my brothers and sisters, we seek forgiveness when we are not genuine. So we say, oh Allah, I will never go back to that adultery again. And at the back of your mind, you say, hey, I just wish I get another opportunity. Astaghfirullah. This is man. If that is the case, then what type of seeking of forgiveness do you have? A person pinches from you something and they come to you and say, hey, look, I'm very sorry, man. I stole your phone the last time. Firstly, where's the phone? And secondly, if you think in your mind, hey, you've got a better phone now, I better make amends with you so that I can actually be in the same car again once with you so that I can steal this one here as well. If that is the way we're thinking, will you really be forgiven? Will I be forgiven? No, but I need to say, I'm really sorry. Here is your phone. In fact, I've bought you a new one because the other one was new and I stole it. Here it is. Allah says, I don't want things back. All I want you to do is be genuine that you're not going to repeat that sin. So a person who's drunk, a person who's been, for example, addicted onto drugs and so on, if he wants the mercy of Allah, truly, he needs to say, oh Allah, I admit my sin. If you don't admit it, the doors are closed. Oh Allah, I regret my sin. If there is no regret, the doors are closed. There has to be regret. There has to be admission. Then you say, oh Allah, forgive me. And you are genuine in it, that I'm really sorry. I want you to wipe out what I've done, oh Allah. I want you to grant me a new beginning, oh Allah. I want you to let me have a new clean page, oh Allah, with only good things on it. And then we say, and I promise I will not do it again. Four conditions. Then the door is wide open. It's flung wide open. And it's so wide open that now you can ask Allah for whatever else you want. And Allah will give it to you. Subhanallah. But there is one obstacle in the path that sometimes trips us as we're entering the door. And what is it? When we have oppressed fellow human beings, our doors of dua sometimes seem to be sealed. And the door of forgiveness sometimes is such that it's a hindrance. We need to go to the person we've oppressed. And this is why they say, don't oppress people. When you oppress people, they may pray against you and that dua will be accepted readily. اتَّقِ دَعْوَةَ الْمَظْلُومِ فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ حِجَابٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, fear. You should be fearful. You should be worried about a supplication made against you by a person whom you have wronged. Someone whose life you're making difficult. Someone whom you are oppressing. You've stolen their wealth. You've tried to harm them in some way or another. You backbite about them, slander about them and so on. You should be so worried about their dua. If they have to raise their hands against you, you are probably dead meat, as we would say. May Allah safeguard us. So I need to be worried. I need to ask myself, how am I oppressing others? Have I wronged you? Have I stolen your wealth? Have I hurt you in a way that is totally unacceptable in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If that's the case, for my link with Allah, I need to sort out my mess with the creatures of Allah. I tell you why. Because everyone here has equal access to Allah. You are creatures to Allah just as I am. What gives me the right to be wronging you or to be oppressing you, and I want a link with the one who made you? It doesn't make sense. Allah made you, didn't He? And Allah made your enemies as well. So subhanallah, if you dislike someone and you've oppressed them, one is to seek justice. Someone stole your wealth and you, subhanallah, you go back and you take them to court and what have you. That's fine because you want your wealth back. They've oppressed you. But one is to harm someone. You are oppressing them. What did they do to you? Nothing. You're just jealous, or perhaps there is some other reason which is invalid. Remember, they are creatures of Allah. Perhaps they may be closer to Allah than you ever would be. So therefore, one of the signs of closeness to Allah is the fact that you don't harm His other creatures. So much so, even animals are not to be harmed. So much so, even plantation and vegetation is not to be destroyed or removed destructively. No, if need be, you may take it out, but not in a destructive manner. And this is why the term Bismillah, in the name of Allah, is used even when we might be slaughtering an animal for consumption purposes. But it's in the name of Allah. It's humane, because these are the creatures of Allah. These are those which Allah chose to make. I better have a good relation with them so that I know that the one who made them and made me, is the one that I'm asking to help me in my problem, the problem that I have. So sometimes because we are oppressing people at home, you're oppressing your wife, then you want the mercy of Allah, how will it come? You're oppressing your children, you're oppressing your husband, and so on. How will the help of Allah come? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us clear our doors, and may He open that door such that there are no obstacles. So once we have, inshallah, opened that door, now we go forth. But there is another issue, another block. Like we say today, we are speaking about why sometimes our du'as are not accepted readily. Sometimes we are unkind to our parents. Did you hear this? Unkind. If your parent is instructing you to do something wrong, or they happen to oppress your spouse, for example, it is up to you to stand up for what is right, but in a kind manner, in a just manner, in a beautiful manner. You get up with a smile and you correct your mother. No harm. It does not mean that because in Islam, kindness has been prescribed for a mom 3 times more than a dad, that you just allow her to trample over everyone. No, she is a human being as well. But what this would entail is that you need to be kind to her when you are correcting her. Oh, my beloved mom, I love you so much. Kiss her on the forehead, embrace her and tell her, my mom, I really love you and I want paradise for you just like I want it for myself. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a beautiful way of correcting our own parents. But you do not be unkind towards your parents, uttering bad words, swearing your mother, swearing your father. How do you expect the one who created you to answer your call and your prayer and your supplication when you are unkind to those whom He chose to bring you into the world? He chose them to bring you here. And you are unkind to them, you swear them. You just slap them on the face and you walk out. You don't even want to greet. Our homes are void of happiness because when we enter, we don't make salam. When we exit, we don't make salam. No longer. I'm gone. My mother's busy crying all night. Where's my son? And I couldn't even send a message to say, Mom, I'm fine. I'm okay. I'll be there just now. That's all she wanted. So develop your link with your parents and automatically you will have a beautiful link with Allah. And here we are talking of 2 types of links. One is to obey them in that which is not transgression. And 2 is to be kind to them no matter what. Even if they've instructed you to do something wrong, you excuse yourself from the wrong, but you're still kind to them. You're still okay. You can buy your mother a gift and say, Mom, you know, you told me to slap my wife across her face. Well, that much I don't know about, but here is a flower and a rose for you. And you know what? It comes from my wife. Allahu Akbar, mashallah, mashallah. What a beautiful way of solving a problem. Even if it didn't come, you can give it to her. Because you know, sometimes you have this issue. But my brothers and sisters, Allah knows that when we are given so much, when we are given so much in this dunya, do you know what happens to us? We become distracted from Him. It's a fact. When Allah blesses you and you've got a good salary and a lovely wife and beautiful children, everything is being thrown at your feet. Sometimes we tend to forget Allah. So the quality of our prayer is not grand. But the minute Allah creates a problem in our lives, we are immediately calling out to Him. Let me give you an example. There were builders building on this building, perhaps on the 11th story. They were still trying to get the structure up. And this headman tried to attract the attention of one of those who was known as a hard worker. Hard worker in the sense that he comes to work, he's working hard, he wants to earn a salary. So he throws a $20 bill at him. And when he throws the $20 bill at him, it lands near him. But the builder doesn't even notice, he just carries on. And another $20 bill. The builder carries on. And the headman says, hey, I need to attract this man's attention. But look at this, I'm throwing these dollar bills at him and he's not even being attracted. And then he throws another $20 bill the third time. And the builder doesn't move. He carries on doing his work. So he picks up a stone and throws it straight at him. And immediately the builder looks up and says, what's the matter? The moral of this whole thing is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a relationship with us whereby when we are getting our money, we're not attracted to Him. When we are getting wealth, nothing goes close to Allah. When everything is being thrown to our feet, we're so happy. The minute you have a problem, there's a stone in your path. Oh Allah, what has happened here? That's what happens to man. That's what happens to man. So Allah says that stone was a blessing for you. I really gave you the whole world and you did not read Salatul Fajr. So one day I just let you be diagnosed with a sickness that you got worried about. And you were there for Fajr first. You were actually waiting to open the door of the masjid. My house, my worshipper, I love you so much. Don't you realize that was just a little stone to draw your attention towards me. That's Allah. So my brothers and sisters, do not underestimate the value of the problems that come into your life. They are perhaps because we've been distracted too long from Allah. Allah's blessed us with everything, and this is why 100% of us have problems and issues in our lives that perhaps are not exactly the way we want it. Health matters, wealth matters, social matters, whatever other matters, that is the means that we will continue to remain close to Allah and maintain that closeness in a beautiful way. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls us. And what I said earlier is very, very correct. That when we are blessed with so much, sometimes we don't even want to call out to Allah. Why? What do you have to call out to Allah for? That's what someone might be thinking. That look, I've got everything. So Allah says, hang on. I want you to understand that if you don't call out to me, I become angry. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ اللَّهَ يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. Whoever does not ask from Allah, Allah becomes angry with him, upset with him. So ask Allah for your needs. Don't think that you're the big deal, because ultimately He was the one who gave you the energy you have, the brains you have, the health you have, and every means that you have, He gave it to you in the first place. Acknowledge it and turn towards Him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us and He's taught us. Now, sometimes a person is calling out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he's got an issue and a problem. But he was eating haram. He was usurping the wealth of people. He was consuming interest. Perhaps he was eating that which was not halal at all. Perhaps he stole property and ate. And the clothing he got, he purchased it with wealth that did not belong to him. Perhaps he stole it in one way or another. And there are many ways of stealing. Stealing is not just pinching. But stealing is to take wealth that is not rightfully yours, no matter how you've taken it. Whether it's conning, deceiving, conniving, whatever else. You can use the terms. If you know deep down that I have actually conned someone out of this wealth, believe me, it is wrong. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كلوا من طيبات ما رزقناكم. O you who believe, eat that which is pure that we have granted you as sustenance. Consume from that which is طيب, that which is pure. And this is mentioned in the Quran, but was repeated by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he was speaking about the response to dua. He says, if your eating is pure and your sustenance is pure, you have unlocked the door of the acceptance of your dua to Allah. If I'm eating pure, even if it's less, when I call out to Allah, Allah knows, hey, this man's wealth is pure. He has thanked me for it. Let me give him what he's asking me. But the minute it is haram, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he read this verse, do you know what he said that? After that, he says, he spoke about a man on a long journey in the desert and he is dirty, he's unclean because obviously he is so, so tired and he's lost and he's really in desperate need and he stretches his arms out towards the sky saying, oh Allah, grant me. Imagine Allah is merciful, isn't it? But Allah says, how does he expect to be responded to? When his clothing is haram, when his food is haram, when whatever has made all his flesh is actually from haram, how does he expect us to respond to him? Imagine. So one is your clothing being haram, two is your food and drink being haram, but the worst of the lot is when your flesh has been built from that which is haram, now what to do about it? This is why the hadith says any droplet of flesh that has been made by that which was haram is not allowed entry into paradise because it is dirty. Such a person will have to go into hellfire to get it burnt off before they qualify to get into paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. We make amends from now and here. This is why we're talking about this, because it's important for us to earn that which is pure. And this is when the dua will be answered. Then also, a person who is calling out to Allah in order to facilitate for him that which is wrong. Oh Allah, I really love this girl, Ya Allah. Make it easy for me to get to her, Ya Allah. But in your mind, you're not planning marriage, you're not planning anything. So you're talking about haram. Do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer that call of yours? In fact, shaitan will just be pushing you along. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May we not be from amongst those. A person going to steal and he says, oh Allah, tonight I'm going for the big one.
Make it easy. Make sure they don't see me, Ya Allah. You know I'm a poor man, Ya Allah. I'm going to knock them at 6 o'clock in the morning, Ya Allah. Help me, help me. And then at 5:59 you say, Ya Allah, here's the kill. If that's the case, we are playing the fool with Allah. You do not call out to Allah asking Him to facilitate haram for you. You're in a business and you say, Ya Allah, I'm going to be stealing, but Ya Allah, help me so I don't get caught. No, that is something that is foolish. And this is what we are warned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another very, very important thing that we need to be careful about. If you want to achieve the mercy of Allah, have mercy on others. Straight, that is the talk. You want Allah's mercy, you want Him to respond to you, well, you need to learn to reach out to other people. We spoke about this slightly earlier, but let me repeat it from a different angle. Sometimes we want the forgiveness of Allah desperately, and we don't want to forgive others for what they've done to us, because to us, it's too big to forgive. Well, to be honest, we've done deeds that are even bigger than that, but Allah may forgive. Sometimes the forgiveness is blocked because we could not forgive others. This is why Allah says it clearly in Surah An-Nur. Allahu Akbar. This is a verse that always brings back this shiver in me, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Learn to forgive. Learn to embrace. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? Indeed, Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. So when people wrong you, learn to forgive. It's not easy. It's very difficult. But when Allah sees that you have forgiven others for something they did against you, He will open the doors by forgiving you for what you've done against Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn, wallahi. And I'm challenging you with this because you have really an emancipation from the clutches of your own lack of forgiveness of others. It is actually a burden on your shoulders that is released the minute you forgive them completely, no matter what they've done to you. And people sometimes say, you know what? Well, this person's done it to me once and twice and thrice and four times. Ultimately, what is your aim in life? Ask yourself. If my aim in life is to nail that man, I will keep on nailing that man. But when I get into heaven, or should I say when I get into my grave, what are my chances of getting to heaven? So always ask yourself, how I deal with this crisis, will it make my chances of entry into paradise better or worse? That's the question. If it's going to make your chances of entry into paradise better, then so be it. I don't mind forgiving you, my brother, a million times. But if I am granted entry into paradise, I am set. Subhanallah. That should be our attitude. But sometimes people look at it from a solely worldly perspective. I'm not going to forgive. Okay. Well, do you know when you don't forgive, you also pay a certain share of the price. And you say, well, that's not fair. I don't know whether it's fair or not, but it is reality. That's what I do know. Because when I hold it against you, I don't want to greet you. I hold it against you. I walk past you. You greet me and I don't respond because I got something against you. The man is dirty. He is also a worshipper of Allah. Just reply him. What are you losing? What are you losing, my brothers and sisters? Just reply. Be the better one. In fact, just greet. In fact, subhanallah, you will be the better one. I tell you, sometimes when people walk away from you, ignoring you completely, it is a sign that they are not at peace with themselves. It is a sign that they are not at peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have a lot to work on. And this is why I understand the nature of this life. This life is so temporary, it is a test. A test whereby you get brownie points. And those brownie points are multiplied 50-fold when you forgive someone else. So if I'm scoring 10 a day, for example, through my salah and other good deeds, one day someone has wronged me. And I've forgiven them, oh Allah, I forgive. And I don't even want to talk about it. Carry on and lead your own life. And suddenly I get 1,000 points. Where did I get them from? You got them because today you engaged in something that was so hard, so difficult. Not only do we love you as a result, not only will we answer your dua as a result, but we want to give you 1,000 points. This is obviously just an example. This is Allah. So Allah watches us. And Allah says, you know what? You want the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Well, you must be merciful upon others. You want Allah to respond to your call? Don't be from amongst those who cannot even assist others in a small piece of assistance. I'm sure you've heard the verse, وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَاعُونَ. Those who prohibit assisting, even, or those who don't help, even the small help, small assistance. Someone comes to you, brother, I just need to borrow your pen for a minute. No. And you walk away. A big deal. Allah watched it and He saw it. Brother, do you know what? I just need you to tell me the time. I don't want. Even the women don't do that anymore. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness. May He protect us. My brothers and sisters, these are some of the keys to open the doors of response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I want to tell you something even greater. Still, with our muck and our mess, and with everything, Allah still gives us because He loves us. All of us here, what don't we have? Let's be honest. We are breathing, we are looking, we are sitting, we are, mashallah, a few things Allah has tested us with, but Allah has blessed us with much more than we deserve. I want to call upon you to turn to Allah. When we call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, learn to make peace with your relatives, your family members, and the others. Go out to mend relationships. That is when you are a person, the minute you raise your hands, wallah, before you even ask what you want, Allah's given it to you, and you don't even know. Believe me, it happens, and it happens to a lot of people, not just one or two. But the problem and the difficulty is, we sometimes sit and we feel, hey, that's a bit far. That's a little bit stretched. Have conviction in Allah. Continue repeating the same dua for 5 years, for 10 years. Take a look at the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet Joseph, may peace be upon him, and the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, his father Yaqub or Jacob, may peace be upon him, he called out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for decades on end. And he always says, I have never lost hope, but I want you, my sons, never to lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Allah knows what I've asked for. Whoever loses hope in the mercy of Allah has disbelieved in Allah, because He is the owner of hope. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all hope. Brothers and sisters, a beautiful day in this beautiful city of Cape Town. I really hope and pray that we've learned something that I've shared here, the benefit for myself and then for yourselves. May Allah make us more conscious of our link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may we be from amongst those who can protect ourselves from the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a way that when we ask for forgiveness, we are genuine, we are actually forgiven. Learn to respond to the caller who calls you for salah, who calls you for ultimate success. That is the ingredient of success. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant it to us in this world and the next. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.